Hello, Schmoville. Well, we're back again, and this last week we did the best movies of 2013. It's time to put the clothespins on your nose, because here comes Fartbox City, the stink of all stink. What stoinks in Schmoville?
You know, Christian, some sad news this year is that Blockbuster closed the remaining 300 stores. The silver lining in that is that now that's one less way that people are going to have to suffer through these 10 movies. These are the worst of the year. Thankfully, 2013 didn't give us too many smelly films, but the ones it did, we're going to have to vent about.
See, I thought that when we were going through this list, then I realized the first 2 months were brutal.
Really, those brutal. Were some bad, and then there were some bad ones in the summer that you just kind of repress as a memory because we got so many great Oscar films late in the year, but their upends is about to come. All you fart boxes and piss piles out there,
here we
ready.
Go. All right, Marcus Aurelius, I went last time first, so why don't you go ahead and give your 10 to 6 worst stonky movies of 2013.
Okay, well, I can't do anything until you get the hell out of that seat. Well, it feels kind of weird to do an honorable mention about movies that you hated, but hey, I'm really sorry, Aftershock and Carrie didn't quite crack this top 10. Something that is going to be number 10 is a film that, yes, I actually enjoyed. I actually had fun watching this movie. Is it good? Hell no. I don't care how many great shots of a Carroll Shelby Mustang you have in there. The Getaway, or just Getaway, they didn't even get the. It couldn't even get that conjunctive word in there. Just Getaway. Ethan Hawke, I love you, Death, but man, that movie's really, really stupid. Selena Gomez is a tough hood rat sitting in the front seat. His wife got kidnapped, or his girlfriend got kidnapped by John Voight, no less. And now he's got to drive a Mustang and all these crazy kind of adventures somewhere in some foreign land. Sound good? Check it out. And now we come to a movie that I did truly hate. At number 9 is Pain and Gain. It's not really a pleasant story to tell. It's based on a true story. When you have a dolt of a comedic filmmaker like Michael Bay, it's just in the wrong hands. And The Rock and Mark Wahlberg and Anthony Mackie, hey, they do what they can. But when you have a guy like Michael Bay who loves making big things explode but has no sense of humor whatsoever, it really makes for a tough watch. And it was way too long. Pain and Gain is one of my worst of the year. I hated thinking about this movie. And that's why my face is doing this right now. Number 8, this is why I love doing this show, is because occasionally I say things that a lot of people out there don't agree with. Are you ready? Stoker is my number 8 worst film of the year. I hated this movie. I know it's directed by the guy that did Old Boy, and congratulations on making one good film. You didn't do it with Stoker. I hated watching this movie. It's just, to me, stupid art house directed, saying, oh, look at how clever I am. I get what you're going for. You just missed the boat completely. Nicole Kidman? Yeah, she worked all right in it. Let's keep that hate train going, because I know a lot of you guys love Ryan Gosling, but man, did I hate him, and only God forgives. That is my number 7 worst film of the year. Again, it's one of these things where it's telling you, hey, look at how artistic we can be. Whether we're doing shots of Ryan Gosling staring at his creepy mom, or there's a really stupid fight scene, or hey, let's break it up with some karaoke numbers, huh? That'll get the kids in. Only God forgives. Maybe God forgives, but Mark Ellis doesn't forget. That's why number 7 is Only God Forgives. Man, it's hard to talk about these.
Slow walking.
Number 6, you guys know I love Independence Day, right? One of my favorite movies of 1996 or 7, whenever it came out. Since that happened, those guys haven't made a lot of hits. Godzilla was one of the worst films ever made. And this year, one of the producers came back to make White House Down. Right? That was the name of it, right? Yeah. Okay. See, Olympus Has Fallen is the one that I kind of liked. It had kind of a fun, like, die-hardy feature. You know what? Let's not say that title. We'll get to that later in this list. But Olympus Has Fallen just takes that, and it's Channing Tatum and Jamie Foxx, and it's a complete farce, and it's just not funny. If it was one thing to make a complete spoof of these movies, that would have been something to look at. But this thing, it's just a total mess. The comedy doesn't hit. The action is stupid. It's just a really, really bad film. And by the way, if you're going to make a bad film, try not to make it off of a fun film that came out 3 months before. Olympus Fell, we all saw it, now let's let it die.
Going through these things, because I remember saying to you, it's going to be a little tougher. And then, oh, that stinks, that stoinked, woo!
All these wasted hours of our lives.
All right, well, let me waste some more hours and talk about mine, get the hell out of here. Again, when we were doing our best list, I was like, oh, I'm sorry, you guys missed the list, I wanted to put you in there. This one, you're lucky you missed the list, because there were ones I thought were stinkier. But here's my list of ones that just missed. After Earth, Haunted House, John Dies at the End, Parker, Hansel and Gretel, Stand Up Guys, Bad Milo, Identity Thief, Beautiful Creatures, 21 and Over, The Host, Aftershock, Smurfs Do, Mortal Instruments.
Richard, it's the top 10 list.
White House Down. All right. So those are the ones that didn't make it. Here are the ones that did. Number 10. You want to talk alien movies, Mark? Let's talk about Dark Skies. What a piece of trash this thing was. Kerry Russell doing some stupid horror movie with dumb aliens that looked like special effects made back in 1936. This movie was horrendous. I couldn't stand watching it. It was so dumb. It was the traditional thing like, oh, what do you mean the kids are saying, oh, don't, well, you hear a noise? Oh, don't worry about it. It's nothing else. Dumb. Cliched all the way through and exactly what I hate about horror movies. Get the hell out of there. All right. Number 9, how do you forget about Safe Haven? Easily, you don't talk about it until you have to. Safe Haven is this dumb Nicholas Sparks movie with Julian Hough and, as Mark likes to say, Josh Duhamel.
Duhamel.
Which would be not Josh Duhamel, but we'll go with it anyway. Josh Duhamel is in this movie, and you think, oh, this could be, that is some strange Lifetime movie with a dumb cop and ridiculous nonsense going through. If you don't have to see it and your significant other doesn't drag you to it, so this movie stoinks and deserves to be at number 9. Number 8, Here Comes Santa Claus, Gangster Squad. This was a movie I was super excited for. I thought it was going to be L.A. Confidential, and I thought I was going to have this really kind of old-school gangster feel about Mickey Cohen, and you have Josh Brolin, you have Ryan Gosling, and Sean Penn. What could go wrong? Everything. Nick Nolte's the only fun thing when you watch him. That's all you get. You get that fun stuff. It's shot really silly. The dialogue is dumb. It's just a mess, a pure mess, and I couldn't stand this movie, so that's why it clocked in where it did. Number 7, Percy Jackson and the Sea Crap. I don't know what the whole movie was called. I don't care. Sea monsters or sea urchins, whatever it was dumb. And you can just tell that Logan Lerman was sucked into this contract before he realized he was going to make any other movies, and now he's got to make more of these things. And it was painful. I thought the director, Thor, was his name. You figured he'd be able to do a movie about the gods. Well, he didn't. Everything you're watching with this movie, one thing, if not cheesy and silly, and they tried to become Harry Potter, and they couldn't at all. It was a total misfire, and I don't want to ever see Percy Jackson ever again. Number 6, Mark and I agree that this movie should be on a top 10 stink list, and that would be Getaway. This movie, you got to get away from it, because I always forget who's even the damn star of the movie, and that's Ethan Hawke driving around, and Selena Gomez comes in with a hood over her face, and she's like, I'm a hardcore biznatch, and no, you're not. You're the Disney chick who's trying to get out of that mode, and it's not working unless you're twerking with Robin Thicke. It's really a movie that no one should watch, and it's laughable. Some of the things, there's some good laughs, but you clench your fists going, this pisses me off.
Very good, Christian. I can feel the anger running through you. Let's talk about number 5. The number 5, actually, I'm a big fan of. I like giving people 5. I like $5 bills. When I was a kid, I had a Redskins number 5 jersey for Mr. Heath Shuler. That didn't pan out too well, and neither did this movie that is coming in at number 5. It is a number 5, and when you're number 5 in a movie, that means you're probably running that franchise into the ground. So let's talk about number 5, Scary Movie 5. Spoof movies have been suffering for a while, and this is just one of the worst that I've ever seen. It made poor Leslie Nielsen roll over in his grave, and when he did that pratfall inside his tomb, that was probably funnier than anything that happened in Scary Movie 5. Stop making these movies, and if you're going to make them, please stop putting Charlie Sheen in there. It's not funny anymore. It hasn't been funny for quite some time. Thanks. Well, we just can't seem to get off this number 5. That number 4 is another 5. Die Hard 5. I can't even call it Die Hard 5 because this really was not a Die Hard movie. A Die Hard movie either takes place at Christmas time or it has Samuel L. Jackson, and this one had neither one of those things. What did it replace it with? A really, really, really bad plot with John McClane and his son who is in Russia now, and they have to stop some sort of communist regime from a villain who likes to eat carrots. Now, I can identify with that. There's a guy that ate carrots. There's a guy that ate carrots in the movie. That's one of the menacing bad guys, is a guy that's munching on carrots. This was so not a Die Hard movie. And look, maybe it could have worked as just a bad, clunky film. However, when you put Die Hard on the poster, you know that's going to get me to come in. And so when I come in looking forward to this once great franchise, I'm going to leave really pissed off if you don't deliver. Bruce, baby, what happened, Bruno? Come back to us, McClane. Is Reginald Vell Johnson around? Can somebody get Al on the horn? We need someone to come in and save this franchise. Number three. Well, who said you can't have fun with a bad movie that's this high on the list? Not this guy. Let's call up Halle Berry, give her a really bad wig, and see what we can do to get Abigail Breslin out of a trunk. The most fun you can have watching a bad movie is The Call. It starts out stupid, and oh my god, does it get better from there. It is one of the dumbest movies I've ever seen, and if you think it's dumb at about the hour 15 mark, just keep watching. It gets better. You have maybe the most stumbling, bumbling, stupid NFL football follies villain I've ever seen. This guy looks like a freshman who drank too many Jaeger shots as he's trying to kidnap this chick. And again, the ending is one of the all-time best bad movie endings I've ever seen. Look at the smile on my face. The Call, you actually did your job. I actually feel bad that I put you on this list because you gave me so much pleasure for 90 minutes. However, you still suck. You're one of the worst movies I've ever seen. So you definitely earned the number three slot. Number two. Kids, comedy is very, very hard. I respect any guy or gal who has the metaphorical balls to try to make other people laugh. However, when balls on Hugh Jackman's chin are the funniest thing in a movie, that definitely deserves a primo spot on this list. Movie 43 is simply one of the worst theater experiences I've ever had in my life. I had to slog through that thing Thursday at midnight because God knows no studio would screen that movie ahead of time, and there's a reason why. It is a collection of some of the least funny, gross-out sketches I've ever seen. How they got all these stars to be in this movie, I have no idea. They must have dirt on everybody in Hollywood. Let's just pray that movie 44 never comes out. One of the worst, just, it made, I was leaving the theater and I was like, why do people even try to laugh anymore? Why do we even try to have joy when this is something that could possibly happen out of our desire to laugh? Christian, get back in here.
Okay. I really feel your pain. And, yeah. And a lot of, there's a few on that top five that's going to be on mine. There's one that I think is missing for yours, and I'm shocked that it's missing. Okay. But anyway, okay, so that was your five through two. Oh. Get the hell out of here, yeah. So I can get through this, so then we can tell you guys our number one once he gets back in. All right, here we go, guys. Number five, I'm going to push with Mark Ellis and go with Scary Movie 5. What a dumb, dumb movie. And why? It's just like they just try to get dollars off of these stupid premises. Spoofs don't work anymore. They just don't work unless you have the right talent to do it. It's just the same jokes over and over and over again between Scary Movie 5 and Haunted House and all these dumb movies that just don't work anymore. The format is dead and it's very, very tough to do, and this movie did not do it. Poop jokes, fart, get out of here. Number four, this is the one that I think was missing from Ellis's list, and that would be the Texas Chainsaw reboot. Maybe it's not. I don't know, but it stinks.
It's not good. It's not good.
It's a terrible movie. And when we saw it, we were so angry when we saw this movie. And they make Leatherface a hero. Like, he's an anti-hero, and it's really a sequel to the original one, and the dialogue is so insane that it's really bad. You watch this movie and you just get, it's not entertaining because you're watching, you're going, this is really, I feel dumb for watching this movie. I can't even talk about it. Number three. Da-dan-da-dan-da-dan-da-dan-da-dan-da-dan-da-dan-da-dan. I hate you, Lone Ranger. I hate you oh so much. You're way too long. You have Johnny Depp doing another silly character, being the star of the movie when he shouldn't have been, and Armie Hammer playing some goofy version of the Lone Ranger. This movie was all over the place. It was two different movies. It was a kids movie at one point. It was a hardcore drama in other points, and it didn't mesh, and you talk about getting angry in a movie. I really despise this movie, and it almost made number one, but there were two that I think could justify why this movie is not number one, but it stoinks to high heaven. Number two, yet another push, my friend. Yet another push. I'm going with movie 43. I have to be honest with you guys. When I saw the movie originally, I fell asleep in it. And I didn't tell you this when I saw it. And that's probably why the score was a little higher than it should have been. I watched this again on cable so I could really get everything in that I could. And it is the dumbest movie that has ever hit the face of the earth. There's nothing funny. Everything's supposed to be funny, and there's blackmail tapes on all these actors that were in it, and how they were able to do this movie, and how they were able to survive their careers. It's like The Blacklist. It really is. This movie is like a blacklist on famous actors. It's so stupid. Bad. It's like the worst sketch comedy show you could ever think that's ever been created in a movie on screen. It's dumb, and if you watch it, then shame on you. Shame on you. All right, Mark, that was tough.
It has been therapeutic for me to get to talk about these things now. I will say the Texas Chainsaw Massacre, while it was not one of my favorites of the year, as a matter of fact, it was one of my worst, but it didn't quite crack that top 10 because, hey, you try to make a silly horror movie, there's Leatherface in there, there are things that I could enjoy in that that just because I didn't leave that film as upset as I did something like a Stoker or Only God Forgives or one of these big franchise films that are supposed to be great, like a Scary Movie 5 or a Die Hard 5 or number one on my list.
All right, so then I'm going to go with my number one because you went with one last time. My number one, you just mentioned it, and it was in your list. That would be Die Hard 5. here's why. Because when you see Scary Movie 5, and you see these movies like Movie 43, you know going into it that there is a fantastic chance these movies are going shingle.
Yeah, and they were.
And they were. With Die Hard, there's hope. Because John McClane is one of the most iconic characters of all time.
Yippee-ki-yay.
You leave this movie depressed. It's true. You leave this movie depressed because you watch John McClane with this forced relationship with his son, and he's not John McClane. He's Bruce Willis from The Expendables. He doesn't care. He's there for a paycheck. As Kevin Smith says, he doesn't even care about the diehard fans anymore. And you watch this movie, and you know it because he just, it's not there. And they cut out the last word of the movie, and it was John McClane looking up and going, Mulligan, because they're going to make Die Hard 6.
Breakfast Ball?
Yeah. So that's why this movie makes number one for me, because it's a pure disappointment. No one cared. And even the fact that the director had said at one point, we don't need John McClane to have that kind of sense of humor. He had no idea who John McClane was. And that's why the director was the best villain in the Die Hard franchise.
Now, if you take the title Die Hard off that, I can understand that that's just merely a bad, clunky action movie as opposed to something that's ruining a franchise, something that was even worse and something that was more sickening to my stomach. And I can forgive films, like little films, like a John Dies at the End. Did I love it? No, I actually didn't like it that much at all. Mm. But it was a nice little try by guys who really wanted to make a movie. Yeah. However, when you have a huge budget and you get stars and you get a big-time director and you have everything that you could possibly need to make a good movie and you come up with one of the stinkiest piles that I've ever seen, that would be called The Lone Ranger.
Wow, number one.
I hate The Lone Ranger so much. It actually ruined, not only did it ruin the TV show, it ruined that classic William Tell overture for me. I don't ever want to hear that again because all I think about is just the dead 180-pound weight known as Army Hammer walking around in this thing. And then Johnny Depp, he's just doing a bad impression of a Native American. It's one of the worst films I've ever, ever, ever seen. Never make this again. And for God's sake, so now you got to see it on TV when it comes out because it's a big budget movie and it's the summertime. So every time I go to Burger King and get a Whopper, I have to look at the stupid Tonto face. Stop making these movies.
Get the bird off your head, stupid. That is it. That is the top 10 stoink piles of the year. And this is where you guys get to have a blast. Mm-hmm. You can tell us what you agreed with, what you didn't agree with, and then go ahead and list all top 10 of the worst films that you saw this year. What was the stoink?
And as we ride into 2014,
January,
we know we're going to get some that are going to be on our list next year. But you know what? We're going to do this because we love you guys and we love seeing good movies. We're willing to risk the bad ones. Christian, let's ride into the future.
I want to give him some more future. Best and worst. This series, the best and worst, will return in January. Mm-hmm. But if you check out on our channel, you're going to get some special footage very soon. So make sure you're subscribed. Keep refreshing because you're getting something very soon, a very special gift for you guys for the holidays.
Lengthy up already.
Maybe. Check it out.
Look in your stocking. No, keep going. Keep digging.
But have a great year, Schmoville. It was a lot of fun. 2013, we love you. Thank you for all the brand new subscribers, for all the old subscribers. Schmoville, you rocked. For the podcast listeners, everybody, Twitter, Facebook, do the whole thing. We'll see you in 2014. Good night, Schmoville.
Yippee-ki-yay, Schmoville.